Hey everyone, my name is Carmen and I'm a power applications engineer here at TI. In my first video, I gave you an overview of what multiphase buck regulators are and what applications they're good for. In this video, I'll be working through a six-phase design for powering the core voltage of a networking ASIC. Once again, this video follows along with a new app note I released earlier this year that covers multiphase design in more detail than we'll talk about today. So let's get cracking on the design, shall we? Here are the specs for our design, and they're meant to mimic the basic requirements of a generic, high-powered processor you may find in server applications. Most of the specs are pretty straightforward to anyone who's done a DC-to-DC switcher design before, with the possible exception of two, the DC load line and the PM bus. With a DC load line, a buck regulator will essentially look like a fixed resistor voltage divider with whatever might be on its load and act accordingly. For our design, with a 200 amp load, the 0.9 volt nominal output voltage will drop by 100 millivolts to 0.8 volts at the output node. When the load current decreases, the output voltage will increase appropriately. This function serves two purposes that benefit us as designers. Benefit one, it lowers the power consumption of the processor by 20 watts, simplifying the design of a heatsink and thermal solution. This 20 watt difference is not dissipated by the buck regulator, it's just simply not drawn from the input supply. It's an important thing to note. Benefit two of a DC load line is it makes it much easier to meet the transient response requirements and greatly reduces the number of output caps. We'll dive deeper into that later on into the design though. Our second interesting design spec is the PM bus requirement. PM bus stands for Power Management Bus, and it's an industry standard interface that's very close to I2C. You can find it on all sorts of regulators these days, both single and multi-phase. The bus allows for on-the-fly output voltage changes, load current and FET temp telemetry, fault recording, compensation changes, and many other features. It's commonly used for server applications where operators are looking to squeeze out every last bit of performance from individual regulators and the system as a whole. We can start our design by quickly determining the number of phases we need. With 240 amps as the max current, keeping individual phase currents no higher than 40 amps requires six phases. Now that we have our phase count, we can then go ahead and pick an inductor value. This is done using the same equation you would normally use for a single phase design, but just be sure to use the max phase current and not the total design current. I'm also going to go with a 600 kHz switching frequency with this design to sit in that middle ground between high efficiency and better transient response. For a ripple current target, we'll use 25%. Plugging in the numbers, this gives us an inductance of 138 nanohenries, so we'll go ahead and use 150 nanohenry choke since it's the closest common value. Moving on, we can now tackle the issue of picking our driver and power MOSFETs from one of three available options. Option one is an all-discrete solution using separate ICs for the controller, driver, and FETs. Option two combines the controller and the driver portion while using discrete FETs for each phase. Option three has a controller with a driver plus FET package for each phase. To keep this video under a day and a half in length, we'll just briefly talk about the pros and cons of each, but it's really a topic worthy of its own video. An all-discrete solution offers a great deal of design flexibility at a low cost, especially when you use common footprint components. Should your design requirements change, it's easy to swap out new parts that can be dropped in with minimal changes. However, it calls for a great deal of optimization to be done by the designer and a close attention to detail to be paid on the PCB layout to get the best performance. It's also not the most compact solution available from an area standpoint. Integrating the controller and drivers together works for low phase count designs, say two or three phases, but it gets impractical when a high phase count is needed. Layout for each phase would most likely not be identical, which can cause current imbalance issues and other performance headaches. Design flexibility is also lost because the fixed drivers reduces the option of available FETs. Using a controller and a separate IC integrating the gate drivers and FETs offers the easiest design with a high degree of density at the expense of some cost. It's the easiest option for getting an optimal layout. There's reduced parasitics affecting efficiency and performance, and you're guaranteed to have the optimum driver FET combination for high efficiency. Should common footprint parts be used, there's still a good deal of design flexibility should the requirements change at all for your design. For our design, I chose to go with option three and use a controller and driver MOSFET IC for each phase. Specifically, I'm going to go with the CSD95490 Smart Power Stage because it can easily handle the 40 amp max we're expecting, and it has headroom for overcurrent protection as well. It also eliminates having to design and tune a DCR or resistor sense network because of the integrated current sense circuitry, which saves us having to lay out six differential pairs down the road. This part also contains some extra features that enable fault reporting and temperature monitoring without needing any extra discrete support circuits. PM bus telemetry just became much easier, and hey, why work harder than we have to? When choosing input caps, it's common to use a combination of ceramic capacitors and aluminum bulk caps. The ceramic caps are distributed between the phases to keep the DC ripple on VIN within spec during steady state operation and must be able to handle the RMS ripple current requirements as well. Big bulk capacitors help provide charge to all phases during large load transients and keep VIN within its AC limits. Following the procedure in the app note, we can calculate that we need two 22 microfarad 1210 16 volt X5R ceramic caps per phase to handle both the DC ripple and RMS current requirements. Calculating the bulk capacitance isn't as straightforward as it is for the ceramics, and it's the best method I've found is using the steps outlined in reference 10 of the app note. From that document, we calculate we need two 330 20 milliohm bulk caps to hit the AC targets of our design. Again, bulk caps are somewhat of an art, and these values should be considered starting points for your design and fine-tuned on the PCB while you're doing your validation. Output capacitance is also implemented using both bulk and ceramic caps, but using all ceramic for a design is possible for some applications. For high current performance applications such as this one, with a 150 amp load step, the amount of capacitance needed to meet the transient specs will far exceed the amount calculated for DC ripple, so meeting the transient will automatically give us the other spec for free. Meeting the AC specs and Vout requires calculating the capacitance needed for both the load step and the release, as the numbers are very different. During a load step, it takes the inductor current, equivalent inductor current in our case, some amount of time to slew to the higher current value. The space between the curves, Q undershoot, is the charge difference that has to be provided by the output caps to the load, which causes Vout to undershoot. On the load release side, excess charge stored in the inductors has to be transferred to the output caps because the load no longer needs as much current. This excess charge to the caps causes Vout to overshoot. Using the equations in the app note, we get the following values for over and undershoot charges. From these numbers, it's just a matter of dividing the charge calculated by the allowable voltage swing on Vout to get the values you need of capacitance to hit the transient specs. This is where the DC load line comes back into play and helps greatly reduce the amount of capacitance on the output. Without a load line, Vout can only swing within the plus or minus 5 volt window on the spec table, which gives us plus or minus 45 millivolts at 0.9 volts out. With the load line, however, the output voltage would still drop by a voltage equal to the load step current times the load line value even before you consider the AC spec on Vout. For our design, with a 150 amp step with a half milliohm load line, this buys us an additional 75 millivolts of swing in the output. Now we can size C out for 120 millivolts plus or minus instead of only 45. Plugging in the numbers, we get 273 microfarads of capacitance to hit the undershoot spec and 2.7 millifarads of capacitance to hit the overshoot spec. But before we move on, it's important to understand why the overshoot comes out so much higher than the undershoot. During a load step, charge is pulled from the output caps by the load, while at the same time charge is being replaced by the energy stored in the inductor as it slews to the new current value. This trickle of charge from the inductor helps reduce the undershoot on Vout. When the load current releases, though, to a lower value, the capacitor charge is no longer being depleted, and now the excess charge on the inductor overfills the cap, causing Vout to overshoot. Since the inductor energy is proportional to current squared, there's so much extra energy stored in these chokes at the time of release than a step, and so the overshoot is usually much greater than the undershoot. For our design, we're going to use a mix of three 470 6 milliohm bulk capacitors, 20 47 microfarad 0805 ceramics, and 25 22 microfarad 0805 ceramics. This will give us a total of 2.9 millifarads of capacitance, which is a bit higher than we calculated in order to account for derating on the ceramic caps, though it's not as severe as what we would see on the input side of things. The last piece of our design is to choose a controller that pairs with our smart power stage. I'm choosing the TPS53679 dual-channel multi-phase controller. It has the necessary pins needed to connect to the CSD95490s, and the DCAP Plus modulator is optimized for multi-phase applications. This controller also offers built-in PM bus support to support the telemetry options in our design specs. And some of the other nice features this controller has are tunable phase add drop points to dial in the efficiency and full compensation tuning through the PM bus using TI's Fusion GUI. No fiddling with RC boxes or soldering components on an analog compensation pin are needed. Finally, it offers the ability to implement a second single phase buck regulator that can be used for a low current auxiliary rail the processor may have as well. As we close out this video, let's quickly look at a comparison of our design versus a lower phase count design. Some of the things that jump out from the table are the higher power loss numbers in the FETs and inductors for the individual phases in that design. If the phase count drops low enough, our inductor and FETs couldn't even be used at all, regardless of heat sinks or airflow across the board. The design would have to be completely redone from scratch. Also, look at the capacitance difference going from six phases down to one. 2.7 millifarads versus 15.7. That's a huge savings. Just for fun, I included the capacitance numbers calculated assuming no DC load line, and you can see it makes millifarads of difference in all cases. Well, that's all we're going to cover today. Thanks a lot for watching, and I hope you learned enough to get started on your next multiphase design. Click here to see the full application note for a deeper dive into multiphase bucks, and stay tuned for more videos where I discuss testing and multiphase design in the lab. Take care now.